This edition of the 10% Show is brought to you in part by Roscoe's. If you love the best dance music and the friendliest people, Roscoe's is the place to go, located at the corner of Roscoe and Halstead. And Outlines Magazine, the voice of Chicago's gay and lesbian community.
Welcome to this episode of the 10% Show. I'm Tony Wilkins.
I'm Sarah Siegel, and we're at the 1990 National Convergence of Girth and Mirth. On this episode of the 10% Show, we'll be speaking with Gabrielle Antolovich, International Ms. Leather 1990, who was here for a recent Women in Leather workshop.
And stay with us as we bring you our profile of PFLAG, Parents and Friends of Lesbians and Gays. Gordon Thomas has a new music video out, and the 10% Show's got it.
And we talked to the cast and crew of Vampire Lesbians of Sodom, all on the 10% Show.
Parents and Friends of Lesbians and Gays, known as PFLAG, is an important group whose work has benefited many people. We have the pleasure of meeting with them and bringing them to you.
I'm Ina, and I have a 28-year-old son, and he's gay. We've known about, I think it's 3 or 4 years, and about 2 years in August. And about, I think, we found out in August, and we were at our first PFLAG meeting in September.
Many arrive with anxious looks on their faces, but within minutes, they're introducing themselves.
My name is Joan, and I've come to this group off and on over the past few years. I have a gay son, 34 years old, who lives in Minneapolis.
They are quickly welcomed to this family called PFLAG. Chicago's chapter of PFLAG has been meeting once a month for the last 7 years, providing support for gays, lesbians, and many parents who've just learned a child is gay. Gay people and their families represent more than one-third of the families in America. PFLAG hopes to bring together children and their parents, but doing so isn't always that easy.
Most of them do have love for their children. I think first thing we do is let them talk to find out where they are themselves and what level of acceptance or non-acceptance they might be. So we first listen to them and let them talk about what their personal experience, because every experience is different. Then you sort of tell them that this is part of, when you find out that your child is homosexual, you have to go through almost a grieving process, because it's as if the child has died, and what has died is the dream that the parent has had for this particular child. So we explain to them, your feelings are perfectly normal. If you're angry, that's fine. If you're having feelings of guilt, that's all part of the grieving process. So we sort of try to take them through the different and prepare them for the various phases that they might go through until they come, hopefully, to acceptance.
The fact was, we learned so much in the last 2 years about gay men and women, about AIDS, about the whole community, which we would have never even had anything to do with, if I'm going to be honest about it, otherwise, because, of course, we have a gay child.
The Hills admit that at first, accepting their son was not that easy.
It was still a shock. I mean, I don't care what you say, what anybody tells you, it's a shock when you find out and you go through an emotional upheaval of some kind.
We walked in, all of us, I think for the first time, expecting to see somehow something in someone's eyes or the way they looked that would say, yes, I'm gay, or yes, I have children that are gay. What I found were people that looked like members of my family, members of my church, people that I worked with. Really, it's a very well-represented segment from society. That was a big surprise. Support in many ways. It's kind of funny because I'll walk in sometime feeling like I'm sort of on top of the world and I'm there to support people. And the conversation will start rolling in the smaller groups in the second half of the meeting. And I realized that maybe there's something that I've been brushing under the rug regarding my own emotion that really does need some support, and I found it there. There are other times when I go feeling low and just really needing a hug and some support, and I find out that there's someone there that's far worse off than I, and end up being their support. So it's always a surprise, but always rewarding.
David lives with his partner, Mark. They've been members of PFLAG for 2 years, but are at different levels of acceptance. Mark says he fought being gay for about 10 years, but has decided since then to come out to his family and close friends.
The support from PFLAG, I've been able to accept who I am. I've come out to my family. I've come out to most of my friends. I've come out to several business associates, and I'm much more at peace right now, much more peaceful, and my relationship with David has changed a lot because of that, because I'm not trying to hide who I am. And PFLAG's been very helpful in that we can hear how the parents feel. So it's been helpful for me to hear how the parents feel, but it's also helpful for us to go as a gay couple, so that the parents can see that we're not the stereotype of what they think it is for someone to be gay.
I think it was probably the second time I had ever seen my father cry. He was clearly upset. He expressed a lot of personal concerns for himself, which made me think, what were his real reasons that he was upset? He wasn't going to have grandchildren by me. I'm the only son. So it was uncomfortable.
Brenner says intimate group discussions like this one can help the fear and pain diminish.
Well, we have many people come to our meeting. I call them the young people as opposed to the parents, who are in various stages of coming out to their parents. They want to know what to do, how to do it. We also have some people who come to the meeting months after month and use us as their surrogate parents, and that's fine. So we have, those are also some wonderful success stories where we have, you know, young men and women saying, oh, I'm going to come out at such and such a day, and they're nervous, and we prepare them for this, and then the next month we see them again and we say, how did it go? And I'm not going to say in all cases it went swimmingly, but in a great number of cases we have helped people. We are so happy to see them within a couple of months speaking, smiling a little, and sometimes within a year they're marching right up with us in the parade.
How we have always, always one of the most important things in our community are parents of gay and lesbians,
you know,
supporting their children.
That's right.
Loving their children.
It's so important for parents to be there for their kids.
Yes. I mean, the sign's here. We are proud of our gay and non-gay children. Proud parents from DeKalb, Illinois. They came all the way from DeKalb to be here.
This is always a favorite.
One thing that we found heartening a couple of years ago is a mother joined us with her little child in a stroller, and she obviously was too young to have a homosexual child, and, you know, I think this was a non-gay woman, and she just said that she just was so proud of us that she wanted her little daughter to join this group. So marching in the parade is probably a very, very satisfying thing for us to do.
PFLAG's efforts to bridge the gap between gays, lesbians, and their families have not gone unnoticed. Barbara Bush recently wrote a letter to PFLAG's national president, personally denouncing anti-gay bias while endorsing the group's work. PFLAG's efforts seem to be working. The group keeps growing.
And I'm just delighted to see the newcomers here and hope that you can get as much out of this organization as we have to help you deal with a situation which I know you must feel is hard to understand and to accept. But you'll get an education here which you will not get on the outside.
I know, you know, it took me 20 years to deal with it, and I can't, you know, put a stopwatch on them and tell them, you know, you've got 5 minutes and you need to cope with this. But I am hoping that someday we'll reach a point where they'll have a different understanding and we'll all be able to sort of deal with it together.
It's a very, very wonderful group of accepting people. And, you know, invariably, you will like it.
Yes, I will. You've got a friend. You've got a friend. Ain't it good to know you've got a friend? Ain't it good to know? Ain't it
Vampire Lesbians of Sodom is one of the year's greatest theatrical successes in Chicago. Our own Greg Lindemann spoke with the cast of this hilarious production.
Well, folks, we are here on stage following the performance this evening of the two plays, Vampire Lesbians of Sodom and Sleeping Beauty slash Coma.
Orcum.
Or, what's that?
Orcum.
Okay, short for Orcum. Two kind of interesting plays. A lot of you have seen the work. Some of you haven't. It's an interesting evening at the theater. And one thing I want to ask the cast anyway, is to start off with, is where do you guys, like, get the energy? I mean, a show like this has got to be like a tremendous. I mean, it's not like.
Oh, God! These are but your last few moments on Earth.
Yeah. They shall be ours if our screams bring forth the succubus.
Please, sir, I beg of you, if there was any shred of pity or tenderness in your heart, please do not deliver me to these succubus.
We are only following our orders.
You have the eyes of a poet. Sure, you cannot see it as just to send me to this most horrible of deaths.
Oh, I wish there was something I could do.
Oh!
Guys, come out here and you do the show, and do you ever feel like they're not getting it out there? I mean, have you ever come out?
Always. It's only a comedy. We're just kidding.
I mean, have you had, like, nights where you come out here and you've done the show and they're not catching on?
Yeah. I see a lot of print dresses. I know we're in trouble.
Or blue hair. Blue hair.
Where do your people hail from?
I hail from Ishbar in Asia Minor.
You know, the Fertile Crescent.
So, what brings you to Sodom?
But I've come to seek my fortune.
I mean, the scene in the theater scene in Chicago, anyway, seems to be taking on a lot of different dimensions. A lot of people are doing different things.
I think it's becoming more risky.
It is.
I mean, here's a commercial production called Vampire Lesbians of Sodom. Our hardest marketing problem is the title and getting people from Schaumburg in.
Are you a courtesan? I am the dreaded succubus.
And then I went to New York and saw it because it's really tough to read style like is in the show into a script at times. And it was funny. And I thought, but I thought we could do better here in Chicago. And there's a lot of comments we hear is that this production's a lot better than the one that was in New York.
And how, you may ask, do I face the prospect of a millennium of time on my hands? What keeps me going is a sense of humor.
There ran a myriad of people that I knew could play the roles better. One of the first people sitting in the theater that I thought of was this man here, Tom Dorfmeister, that I just worked with prior to going to New York. And people like Tom kept popping in my head. And people like Peter, who won the Jeff, never occurred to
me. Oh, he won the Jeff.
Okay, I get my $10 now.
Now I need to introduce myself. I'm Gregory Salazar, vampire hunter!
Take this tip, buddy. Stay away from the queens in this company.
I heard that, Miss Vec. Stay away from the queens. Indeed!
I auditioned for Dog at his office, and I got picked.
You've done a lot of stage work.
Yes.
Another people out here will rip their tongue out, which will transform you into ancient hands. The decaying skeleton.
of like horrid B movies like Attack of the Killer Tomatoes and like The Ants That Ate My Pants and stuff like that. Vampire Lesbians of Sodom.
So you would
get to my eyes. She knows everyone that we had breakfast with Wallace Reed, lunch with Alma Rubens, tea with Clara Kimball Young, and dinner with Ron Woodock. This place is a social gold mine, and I'm reaping in the nuggets.
The movies of the 50s where the vampire was a woman and she bit the neck of another woman who was in turn her lover, no one in the 50s ever said, oh my god, she's a lesbian. You know, so I think Charles Bush was saying, hey, there were women vampires who liked other women, so why not do that and make them lesbians?
In your ignorance, you fancy my life to be one of extravagance and magic. How wrong you are! Yes, I have my slaves that do my bidding, but they are semi-human primitive creatures and far from scintillating dinner companions. My head reels when I think of what you did to the Girl Scout troop in 42. Hey!
Well, I sure hope so. I'm Madeline's slave, Cody Shay.
And wherever did you two meet? Right here in Vegas or beyond the city limits?
Oh, right here in Vegas. I've been on tour with the First Young Republican Christian College Review.
Sex in the leather community may be among the most controversial issues in Chicago's lesbian and gay community. The 10% Show interviewed this year's International Ms. Leather, Gabrielle Antolovich, at her Women in Leather workshop, which educated the ignorant.
Welcome to the diversity of leather women's lifestyles. And the reason why I wanted to talk about this is that I don't know how many thousands of leather men there are here at this contest in Chicago, but I bet that as all these leather men are walking through the city, all the people who have stereotype images of what the leather lifestyle is, that's what they think is happening here. It's exactly what straight people have done to gay people. They have this stereotype image of what the lifestyle is like, and when they see one of us, they go, oh, that's one of them. They must be doing dot, dot, dot. And I'm sure that's what the leather women and the leather men do about each other. And that's what people who are just coming out in leather must think, that there must be something that I am striving to be if I'm interested in leather. It's a very strange mindset. You know, when I first came to America, I didn't know that I was into SM or leather at all. In fact, I didn't even think about it until somebody pointed it out to me. In fact, when somebody met me, they started talking about domination and submission, and I had no idea what they were talking about. The only thing that I could think of was this horrible teacher that I had that had to have her own way all the time. And I hated her guts, and I thought dominance and submission must be about control issues, you know, like I have to have my own way and you will do it the way I want it, and that's what's going to happen. And that to me was abusive. And being a lesbian in the lesbian movement since about the Stonewall days, which, you know, is like the late 60s, we've done a lot of thinking about relationships and what abusive relationships are and what happens in them and how we can change that. And so we as a community have gone toward looking at control issues and how destructive they are. And so here I come all the way from Australia to meet someone that says, domination and submission is a turn on. And I'm going, whoa, this American culture is strange. So anyway, I just let her talk to me, you know, because I made a commitment to myself that I would come to America with an open mind. So anyway, she started reading stories from a book called Coming to Power. Has anyone heard about that book?
Yeah.
It's the first women's SM book, or maybe, I don't know if it's a pure lesbian SM book, but it's the first women's SM book that's been published, and in there are some weird stories. And she was reading one of the weird stories. And as I was listening to them, I thought, what is such a turn-on in getting a butch dyke into pink lace lingerie and making her crawl around and bark like a dog? And I thought, gosh, I don't know what to say. And I don't like to be judgmental right from the beginning, because what if I'm wrong? And I came across the SM scene at the age of 35, I had at least a positive memory to go back to go, yes, I am into this, isn't this fabulous? But I also had all those many years of bad propaganda about SM that I had to get through, because my second reaction was, oh my God, I'm an SM dog. How am I going to face my lesbian feminist friends? And thank God I'm in America, because I don't know anyone. So what I had to do was I had to find other SM dykes and, you know, find out, well, what is this? What am I going to do? How am I going to learn about it? And this is where the diversity comes in. You know, like, not everyone's into dominance and submission. Not everyone's into labor. You know, we have found that everyone has their own thing. You know, it's just like there are a diversity of lesbians and diversity of gay men and straight people. There's a diversity amongst leather people. So in order to find myself in all of this, I had to meet everyone.
I'm with Gabrielle Antolovich, International Ms. Leather, 1990. And Gabrielle, hello. I want to ask you, I'm currently a vanilla lesbian. What does that mean? What does that mean, and what is an SM lesbian?
Well, a vanilla lesbian is a non-SM lesbian. It's just a little funny term that we use amongst ourselves to distinguish the crowd. But an SM lesbian, well, it's a hard one to actually define. It is a very diverse term. You know, it's become almost a generic term. It used to mean very specific things, sadomasochism, where the sadistic person likes to induce pain and gets an erotic charge out of that, and a masochist gets an erotic charge out of receiving pain. That's a very, you know, basic definition. But these days, SM is pretty generic. You know, anyone who's into leather and is exploring their sexuality through power dynamics, you know, dominance and submission and bondage and exciting fantasies that you'll live out.
Thanks very much for talking with us.
Jordan Thomas is a local musician who has finished his latest music video, and it premieres on this episode of The 10% Show.
Stayed on.
took the time to bend my mind not to keep you to myself. I'm not an angry man, I don't yell and shout, I don't throw things or break promises. Break bones, break love, break hearts. I'm not a lying, deceitful man. Now I wonder why in a world of people just like you, is it the only way to get by?
This installment of the 10% Show,
bringing you the best in gay and lesbian Chicago.
Thanks for watching, and don't stop. This edition of the 10% Show is brought to you in part by Roscoe's. If you love the best dance music and the friendliest people, Roscoe's is the place to go, located at the corner of Roscoe and Halsted. And by Outlines Magazine, the voice of Chicago's gay and lesbian community.